You don't believe in God because of Alice in Wonderland?
The kingdom of God is within man.
God loves violence.
Oh, God. Oh, God.
Oh, my God. Deja vu.
Oh, my God. It's a dream.
Oh, my God.
Oh, my God.
Oh, my God.
Why not?
Because of God.
Why are we here? What reason do we have to be? Spinning at 67,000 miles per hour around our sun, soaring at over 7 times that speed around one of the countless billions of galaxies which make up a universe that, according to our understanding of physics, shouldn't even exist in the first place, the oldest question in the book is certainly a fair one of us to ask to the shimmering expanse hanging above. And for just about as long as we've been able to ask it, we've interpreted its response as the number one Family Feud answer of all answers. Survey says, God. And this maybe but probably didn't pacify us for a little while, but unfortunately the human condition never got around to making space for prolonged satisfaction. So without pause, our next existential inquiry came ringing back at the abyss. What is God? And depending on where or who or when you ask, the stars either fell silent or they answered us in spades. 100,000 BC, we start burying each other. 40,000 marks the first cremation, and another 20 after that, we start leaving objects with each other for the afterlife. Shells, dolls, beads, blades, you get the picture. 10th millennium to the 5th century, and sites like Göbekli Tepe and Çatalhöyük start popping up, as well as the Proto-Indo-Europeans with their vague sacrificial ideology. But it's not until Andre 3K that we really start picking up steam. 3200-ish rolls around, and the Neolithic people of Ireland turn 250,000 tons of marble and earth into a passage tomb called Newgrange that aligns with the rising sun of the winter solstice. 100 years later, and we say hello to its little brother, Stonehenge. 3000 flat, an archaic cuneiform begins to emerge. 2635, Pharaoh Djoser commissions the oldest surviving pyramid in Egypt. 200 years later, in the same place, some of the oldest surviving religious texts are composed. 2000, the Epic of Gilgamesh. 1600, Stonehenge just finishes being constructed. 1500, the Rig Veda. 1350, Akhenaten founds a monotheistic religion. The Olmecs build the Great Pyramid. The Chandogya Upanishad is compiled, and Krishna is mentioned for the first time. The first 5 books of the Jewish Tanakh are compiled. They're called the Torah. Gautama Buddha is born, then Confucius. Darius the Great names Zoroastrianism as the official religion of the Achaemenid Empire. The oldest known copy of the Tao Te Ching is inscribed on bamboo slips. Socrates is tried for impiety. Jesus of Nazareth is born. John the Baptist dies. The first Christian council is convened in Jerusalem. 20 years later, the city falls to the Roman Empire. Manichaean Gnosticism, the Ginza Raba, the Mayans, the Edict of Milan, the Western Collapse, the Kojiki, the birth of Muhammad, 9 Crusades, Sikhism, Santeria, Satanism, Candomblé, Baha'i, Rastafarian, Scientology, one God, two God, red God, blue God. The point is, the jury's still out. Or it's never coming back. I don't know. But of all the countless divinations and deviations from then until now, there's one in particular that holds a place in my heart above all the rest, and it was written by this man, Empedocles of Acragas in Sicily, sometime in 400 BC. In his theory of the four elements, Empedocles proposed that there are 2 cosmic forces alone in this world. Those are love, philetus, and strife, nekos. Love is the force of captivation and coalescence, and strife is the force of aversion and separation. The essence of his theory is that these 2 forces are engaged in an endless astral crusade against one another, and they each prevail briefly, eclipsing their opponent only to eventually be eclipsed in return forever. This perpetual Empyrean clash is what causes the 4 elements, water, earth, fire, and air, otherwise without cause to change, to collide with one another and become something different, something greater. Empedocles' proposed struggle was a play in 4 acts, the prevailing act of love, the transition from love to strife, the prevailing act of strife, and finally, the transition from strife back to love. According to Empedocles, the world we live in existed and will always exist in a continuous advance through this play. Love, therefore, is the reason for everything. The reason Han didn't shoot first in 1997 but did in 1977 is the same reason that Michelangelo came to paint the creation of Adam on the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel. And I don't think the divine and serendipitous nature of our lives that Empedocles imagined has ever been captured more purely and more gracefully than by the work of Satoshi Kon. Among the pantheon of truly great artists to which he belongs, I found that it was Kon's filmography alone that was based wholly, totally, in love. His work, more than any other director's that I've seen, embodies what Empedocles envisioned the god of our universe, which only exists by the chance of a coin flip, to be. Love. Anyways, that's what I'm gonna spend the next however long I feel like talking cool about. So put on your thinking caps and strap in. I'm really smart, and this is Satoshi Kon, and Why Love Is All You Need. So we've established that Satoshi Kon's body of work is a contemporary reflection of Empedocles' cycle, but no echo is without its distortion, and this coloring increases directly proportionate to the distance between the source, its reflecting surface, and its listener. What I mean is a bit of time passed between 460 BC and 1990 CE, and EMP's CYCLE changed a bit with it. Rather than the prevailing acts of love and strife, Kon's work proposes the states of love itself, the possession of love, the loss of love, the absence of love, and the pursuit of love. Same metaphysical construct, just remastered. It's not internal affairs, it's the departed. And with our theoretical celestial spinning tops freshly in mind, there's no time like the present to dive into the film itself.
Hey.
Tokyo Godfathers was Kon's third offering to the silver screen, and what I would argue is the least well-known of his major works outside of Japan. Following the success of Perfect Blue and its younger sister film Millennium Actress, Kon decided to reject the creative momentum he had been gaining in exchange for a challenge, both to himself and his audience, in the interest of avoiding a fall into redundancy. Rather than creating another film that would blur the boundaries between dreams, memories, delusion, and reality, his third time back to the plate would be spent tackling a much more traditional, much more restrictive approach to storytelling. And from this restriction would come what is easily the most diverse and absurd film that Kon would ever complete. While Perfect Blue and Millennium Actress were both singular protagonist-led films which relied on their main character's perspective of the society they belong to as a vessel of criticism and meditation, Tokyo Godfathers relies on the society's perspective of its main characters as the vessel. A film which follows its homeless titular trio in a mad dash through the streets of Tokyo to find an abandoned baby's parents that plays like a Saturday morning cartoon. Rather than a focused, slow-burn psychological horror or a nostalgic tale of star-crossed lovers, Godfathers feels much more akin to a quilt, with the various properties of romances, chase thrillers, heartbreaks, coming-of-age stories, comedy trios, and tales of retribution woven into every frame, but one that never focuses for too long on any one in particular. It is, in a sentence, as far in the opposite direction as Kon could have gone from his other works while still arriving at the same destination. The film opens on a Christmas nativity play, specifically this shot of baby Jesus, as the youngest of the three magi recite an abridged second verse of the second chapter of the Gospel of Matthew. As the children's choir in the following shot begin to accompany the organist in their rendition of Silent Night, we cut to a slow pan of the play's almost entirely unconcerned audience, and our first look at two-thirds of the film's leading trio, Hana and Gin. Hana is the singularly inspired member of the congregation, juxtaposed by Gin lying asleep beside her, snoring through the play's closing number. After a quick but impassioned sermon about the absence of love and how heavily it can weigh on the human spirit, we cut to our first exterior shot of the film and are given a perfect 1-2 setup for our deuteragonists. First, they're homeless. Second, Hana is a trans woman, leaning as heavily into her idealism and piety as she can without falling over, while Gin is older, more cynical, and has a seemingly endless well of callous retorts for her or anything else. Following a few brief snapshots of Tokyo's snowy streets, we're introduced to the third and youngest member of our Yuletide Trinity, Miyuki, and our Christmas caper is just about teed up and ready for the drive. Miyuki is a reserved but nonetheless fiercely rebellious teenage girl, lying somewhere between Gin and Hana in terms of disposition. After Miyuki provokes a fight with Hana and Gin provokes a fight with Miyuki, their scuffle is broken so they can retrieve Miyuki's present. Cut to a super wide of a garbage pile, not exactly where one would expect a Christmas present to come from, and they soon discover that the present isn't even there anymore. Someone else must have already scavenged it. Miyuki and Gin break into another fight, and again, Hana struggles in vain to parlay peace between the two, but luckily, the cry of a nearby baby pierces through the commotion, and our trio quickly falls silent. Over the mountain of translucent bags of trash stood behind them, and hidden under a blanket, the three discover an abandoned newborn, light inexplicably pouring out from the basket she's laid in and illuminating their astonished faces. Miyuki stays crouched aside the basket, Gin laments the baby's misfortune, and Hana gleefully cradles her as she begins to walk away. After Gin points out that the police station is the other direction, Hana calls back that the baby is a gift from God and that she's theirs. Cue reaction shot, cue title card, and pause. Let's talk. I know this is pretty on the nose, exponentially more so for a Western audience. The nativity, Hana's religious beliefs, the baby, totally a loose allegory for the birth of Christ. These lost souls in meeting a being of pure innocence and love will find joy in life once more upon the completion of their Bible-adjacent quest. Right? Right. Come on, three godfathers, the other and better, three godfathers, We're No Angels did a similar thing, but it's like a whole family. I think Twilight Zone did an episode. Point is, this isn't particularly subtle and this isn't particularly new. You know it, I know it, Kon knew it. Grab a handful of darts and throw it at a board of critically acclaimed anime and you're bound to hit a couple that employ Christian iconography and metaphor without ever directly acknowledging the religion or Baby Jadakiss himself. FMA Brotherhood, Trigun, Evangelion, Cowboy Bebop, Usagi literally uses a Holy Grail in Sailor Moon, you get the point. And this is because of Japan's extremely troubled history with the religion. The first known instance of organized Christianity in Japan was the arrival of Portuguese Catholics in Kagoshima, way back in 1549, led by this guy, Francis Xavier. They built a church, the locals liked them, and for a while, under Oda Nobunaga's rule, Xavier and his followers fostered a thriving community of Japanese converts, who were encouraged to take on Portuguese Christian names and Western customs following their baptisms. Unfortunately, though, this peace wouldn't last. Nobunaga was famously betrayed by his retainer Akechi Mitsuhide at Honnoji Temple in Kyoto, forcing him to commit suicide while his page set the temple on fire. Things for the Christians started snowballing downhill pretty immediately after this, when Nobunaga's successor, Toyotomi Hideyoshi, rose to power. By the late 1500s, the shogunate's paranoia over foreign influence and possible colonialism had reached a fever pitch, and the foreign Catholics, as well as their native converts, became public enemy number one. A year before Hideyoshi died in 1597, 6 missionaries and 18 Japanese Catholics were arrested in Kyoto and Osaka, and then forced to walk over 500 miles to Nagasaki. It took a month. 2 more were arrested along the way, and when they finally made it to the top of Nishizaka Hill, they were executed by crucifixion for their faith in front of the city. 3 of them were children. From 1598 to 1632, another 205 missionaries and Japanese Catholics would be martyred. After the Shimabara Rebellion, an uprising of mostly Catholic peasants, was ended in 1638, the remaining Christians in Japan were forced to publicly renounce their faith or be met with death. Some continued practicing it in the face of this persecution, becoming known as the Kakure Kirishitan, hidden Christians, but they were forced to conceal their shrines, artifacts, and other objects of worship. And this went on for literally hundreds of years. By the time the people of Japan would be given freedom of religion in 1871, it was kind of too late. Missionaries came back, they tried, but it just wasn't enough. Even today, only 1.5% of Japan's population claim Christian beliefs or affiliation. Christianity is to Japan as Hinduism is to Norway. So, in a country sans paramount Christian presence, but one that still bore massive Western influence beginning in the late 19th century, its representation of Christianity could be kind of half-hearted. Which is why these first 6 minutes maybe aren't as on the nose as they might seem. Because Kon would never make another three Godfathers. Satoshi Kon isn't especially well known for following suit. One of the most consistently emergent themes throughout his works, as well as his interviews, is his dissatisfaction with the status quo, both of the arts he so passionately loved and the people who consumed them. Doesn't like how women are often portrayed as support characters at best and fiat cup holders at worst, so he directs and writes five female protagonists back to back like he's on the cover of Lethal Weapon. Doesn't like the simultaneously obsessive and callous behavior of the consumer due to late capitalism's ever accelerating charge towards overconsumption, so he criticizes otaku and the social institutions that enable them in everything he touches. Rather than following a person through their 9-to-5 to express the monotony of modernity, he highlights what precludes it to remind us of the quiet ecstasies of life. He's Eva Hesse, he's Andy Kaufman, he's Satoshi Kon. K-Dot wasn't just a don in both camps, he was punk as hell in his approach to them. So it is unlikely, at the very best, that Kon would go to such lengths, would give so much unambiguous focus to Christianity, would impose such severe limitations to his form, only to then retell a story that's already had like five direct adaptations, two by the same director. So Chiyoko isn't just another vague cinematic metaphor for the Son of God like Neo or Kevin Flynn or RoboCop. No. Chiyoko is literally Jesus Christ. The opening shot of the film is of Christ in the manger during the nativity scene, but the hair is a brilliant blonde, and all of their distinct features are ones we tend to associate with femininity. This isn't exactly the mask white Christ with chestnut locks that we're used to seeing in much of the West, nor is it the Judean Christ with deep olive skin, brown eyes, and black hair that they historically most likely were. So, straight out of the gate, Satoshi emphasizes to us the deliberate omission of physical details regarding Christ in the Bible. There's like a few of them throughout the whole thing, pretty much exclusively in the Old Testament, and if they're taken to be actual accounts of corporeal appearance, then they kind of contradict one another. What made G.O.D. the top dog according to the good book and its expansions was never physicality, it was universality. In other words, God is a woman, or at least can be, and this baby girl Jesus is wrapped in the same colors as Chiyoko is found in only a handful of minutes later. Following this, we fade to the three magi continuing their reproduction of Matthew 2:2, and yet another fade brings the complete stage into frame. A composition of the nativity of Christ that combines the adoration of the shepherds seen on the left and the adoration of the magi seen on the right into a single contemporaneous event. Narratively, these took place months, if not years apart in the Bible, but artists the world over, basically since Christian art became a thing, have employed this same merger of events to achieve visual and emotional symmetry. Whether they be magi, shepherd, king, or carpenter, every station of humanity will be made equal and humble before the light of God. Rap genius Psalm 72:11. Fade to the aforementioned pan of the audience, and after the camera briefly settles on Hana and Gin, our first hard cut of the film takes us back to the stage, but now only two of the magi remain in frame. Our deuterogonists are not meant to be taken as a subdued metaphor for the magi, they are the magi. So Satoshi shows us their reflections. As Christian traditions evolved, the three magi, kings, wise men, whatever, evolved with them. First was the arrival at how many they numbered. Western Christianity quickly pinned them as three, due to the three gifts they were said to have brought, whereas Eastern Christianity, especially the Syriac churches, mostly settled in at around 12. Then came their names, cultural origins, and ages. Around the 7th century, Western Christianity arrived with the names Melchior, Caspar, and Balthazar. Eventually, they came to represent the three ages of man, as well as three major foreign cultures. According to St. Bede, Melchior was the oldest, a magus of Persia. Balthazar was middle-aged, a magus of Arabia, and Caspar was the youngest, a magus of India. And their ages, depending on tradition, went something like 60, 40, 20, respectively. So, after a glowing angel appears to us, our equally tiered in age outsider vagabonds from the east, or in a more literal translation from Greek, from the rising, make their way by night's cover to what the Gospel of Luke intended the manger to poetically represent. A pile of trash. After their arrival, they're drawn by the cries of a baby, and as they collectively reach down to pull away the blanket left to conceal her, they bow. Their once dark and sullen faces now overwhelmed by light, and their mouths left agasp. This isn't lukewarm allegory. This is Veronese. This is Botticelli. This is Fabriano. This is an echo. And this is also one of the ruling motifs of the film. The Bible, go figure, is chock full of passages about light. I think it's mentioned in like the first page of the whole thing. And this appearance of light is pretty much always meant to represent faith, holiness, or the presence of God. But remember, in Kon's works, love is God. So in TGI Fridays, light and its absence are inextricably connected to the ebb and flow of God, love, present in a given moment. Here, let me show you what I mean. In this scene, following the waitress assassin's failed hit and subsequent split from the Yakuza wedding, and Hana and Gin's ensuing separation, Miyuki is being held in an apartment shared by the assassin's wife. Rather than an establishing shot of the apartment, the scene opens on an extreme close-up, panning from Chiyoko to another baby, identical in size and ambiguous in sex, nursing, further emphasizing the universality we talked about earlier and setting the tone for the environment, for the character, and for the scene. Nourishment. Mom is on the left with the ice climbers, and she is awash with light, her speech and body language exuding this unmistakable maternal empathy, and this is contrasted by an understandably confused Miyuki, huddled in a chair with her knees to her chest, shadows covering all but a sliver of her face. Both when she's staring at the baby's nursing here, and again here when she turns to the myriad of family pictures above the dresser, her face is partially illuminated by the light sources to her right. There is an immediately perceptible connection between the subject of family, her comfort, and the amount of light cast against her face. So when our hostess mentions that her father is a policeman, it's no small wonder that Miyuki is filled to the brim with excitement because her father is too. And for about 5 seconds, the only thing in her is love. So her face becomes overwhelmed with light, despite the fact that she just turned away from its only sources. And as reality comes flooding back to her, as she remembers that she's homeless, that she's a runaway with cause to fear her own family, her eyes fade back to the tired despondency that we've grown used to seeing her wear, and she recedes back into the darkness. We can see this same use of light on Miyuki again in the third act when she calls her father on a payphone. The shadow quickly jumping back to her eyes when she hears him say her name, only for her to immediately fold over in sadness, the dark once again engulfing her face. Another example of this use of light to represent the presence of love, and one of my favorites throughout the film, can actually be found in the scene running concurrently with this one. As Miyuki gets to know her new mom friend and Hana desperately races to find her, Gin comes face to face with the high five. And needless to say, they ain't singing, they bring in drama. After Killahir misses his Ryu standing hard kick, one of the office lights on the right cut out. As he recovers and blocks Gin's escape, not only does his light come back, but the lights to the left begin to fall in turn, as Gin is beaten within an inch of his life. And as a chance invitation pulls the ruthless attackers away from him and out of frame, Gin begins to rise and give chase, so the lights rise with him. Kon has just turned this quiet park clearing into a Guilty Gear stage, and God's presence is the health bars. Whereas Miyuki's scene expresses the more unambiguous, singular kind of love that we each personally experience, it is in Gin's that Kon expresses the abstract, providential love that ultimately governs our experience of the universe. Love is, of course, not what compels the hearts of these gremlin, ultraviolence deliverers. It is the acute absence of love that inspires this kind of separation and destruction. But love is what facilitates their arrival, their departure, and Gin's pursuit of them. Not because they're imperative to his growth, but because they're imperative to ours. We'll come back to this in a second, but before going any further, it's of vital importance that we understand the second most prevalent motif employed by Kon throughout the film, wind. It's the 13th century, and Kublai Khan, grandson of the immeasurably infamous Genghis, has taken his seat as the fifth Khagan of the Mongol Empire, but the colossal kingdom is on the precipice of collapse due to rampant political division following the civil war that Kublai had won to become top chef. In an attempt to keep his quadplex of territories together, he adopted very aggressive imperial expansionist policies, and in one of the hardest flexes throughout the many halls of human history, declared himself the Emperor of China's new dynasty, that he made up like 8 years before he was even done conquering China. So in trying to keep up with the aggressive pace he had set and to satisfy an increasingly shattered empire, KK Slider quickly trained his sights on a solitary chain of misty islands to the east, Japan. In 1274 and again in 1281, the Yuan dynasty launched one of the most powerful and simultaneously unlucky naval campaigns ever. First round, aka the Battle of Bunai, the Yuan forces were driven back to their ships after the samurai of Kyushu gave them some very unexpected free one-day shipping on these hands. You were talking all that shit when I see you square up. It was after this retreat to the relative safety of Hakata Bay that an incredibly powerful typhoon, with no prior indication of approach and over a month out of season, sunk and killed over one-third of the Yuan forces, mortifying the rest and sending them back to their base without the enemy flag. By itself, this is one of the most unprecedented upsets in recorded history, a stroke of natural luck so unfathomable that Kublai planned around it never happening again. And then it happened again. 7 years passed and that young YD set sail again at the opposite time of year and with a naval force so large that it wouldn't be eclipsed for another 7 centuries in a little episode of history called D-Day. Over 4,000 ships carrying over 140,000 men split into two armies tried once more to storm the sandy shores of Japan, but again, exceptionally fierce resistance forced the first wave of Yuan forces to retreat, this time to nearby Imari Bay, where they waited for the much larger second wave to combine with them, like Tuvix from Star Trek Voyager. By August 12th, the two fleets had finally clicked up and were poised to take the country, but the sailors and their captains sensed a coming storm. Their attempt to flee for home, however, was in vain, and they were overtaken by a typhoon even more powerful than the last, bombarding the Tsushima Straits for 2 full days, sinking nearly the entire fleet and marking the last time ever that the Mongols would try to invade Japan. The rapturous back-to-back defeats of their measureless invaders quickly became the subjects of myth. The Japanese felt that the only way they could have been blessed with such fantastic triumphs was that a Shinto god, most commonly thought to be Raijin, the god of storms, had sent the winds to help. And so they granted the sacred typhoons a name. Kamikaze. Divine wind. Kon's use of wind in Tokyo Godfathers rebukes much of the modern world's understanding of kamikaze as Hirohito propaganda reappropriated at the end of a declining war and forcibly reframes it, demanding his audience recognize it for its inceptive, fabled meaning. One of the greatest examples of deus ex machina in the exhaustively long diary of our species. So, where light reflects God's presence or influence, wind is God's unmitigated action. One is something to be seen, and the other is something to be felt. In the moments leading up to Gin's beating, he discovers a withering old man in a brilliant pool of light by a vending machine. It quickly becomes clear that he's intended to be a figurative reflection of what Gin's future will hold if he doesn't alter the path he currently treads, but what may be a little less obvious at a glance is the very literal path that Gin is being led down. Your word is a lamp for my feet, a light on my path. Psalm 119:105. After cutting back to Miyuki and her captor for a hot minute, the ball's back in Gin in the old man's court, this time opening with an establishing shot of the old man's home, the exterior of which has been assembled for a singular purpose, to let us know when the wind is blowing. As the old man drinks more from Gin's bottle, an argent glow from above begins to light his face, while he reflects on the pair's striking similarities. This quiet moment shared between the two, suffering in tandem at the hands of diseases that only they could understand the pain of, and punctuated by the old man's death, is enough by itself to equip Gin with a new perspective, to allow him the rare opportunity for an honest third-person view of himself, and the damage that his addictions and decisions ultimately do to those he loves. But the wind returns. And the old man's life returns, and Gin extends the same favor, and the old man takes the same drink, before falling back in to the same rest. Because it needs us to stay just a little longer. This delay's purpose is twofold. One, to allow the story's advance. Logistically, there's no way our divided trio can find an out-of-focus set of buildings behind an unspecified housing development somewhere in Tokyo when their only lead just got fed like a third of a clip. If Gin is able to jet without spending more time with his elder counterpart, maybe he doesn't feel the need to turn around and steal a last look at him. If he doesn't do that, he never sees the poster, and the trio are soon forced to abandon their crusade. In addition to this, if his departure isn't delayed, even if he did happen to see the towers, without the attack, he wouldn't have been reunited with Hana, Miyuki, and Chiyoko. Rather than avoiding contrivance, Tokyo Godfathers is built on a foundation of it, and light and wind are its celestial facilitators. Which brings us to the second purpose for delaying him, and what I had mentioned earlier, our opportunity to gain perspective. Roger Ebert once said that movies are the most powerful empathy machine in all the arts. I would go a step further and say that film, at its best, is a medium of social workers and activists. Movies are the most universal means with which we can ask countless people, each with their own frames of reference and structures of belief, to see through someone else's lens for 160K frames. And Kon provides a brilliant example of this by punctuating a bittersweet moment of compassion and serendipity with an uncomfortably cold plunge into reality. We got to see the gruff homeless man play funny for 30 minutes and some change, and we got some laughs at his expense, so now we are forced to see him be beaten and ridiculed, treated as less than human for sport by the demographic most likely to see Kon's films. The usually intoxicating bounciness of its score transforms into something much more aggressive, dark, and disorienting, simultaneously invoking a myriad of musical references to the land's long and often violent past. Where there was once sprightly, comedic timing, cartoonish exaggeration, and vibrant, fluid movement, there are now only the heavy and deliberate strikes of a lead pipe, and the sharp crashes of cymbals nervously zigzagging between our ears. This isn't utilizing suffering as a prop, either. This happens to real homeless people with an alarming consistency, and most people don't really talk about it. After the Japanese asset bubble popped in the early 90s, the number of people suffering from homelessness in Japan skyrocketed. And with this surge came a mixture of outright neglect and disdain from the government, as well as much of the middle and upper class that had managed to avoid the fallout. The Tokyo metropolitan government hardly even acknowledged that the homeless existed in any meaningful volume until like 1997, 5 years after the collapse. And a number of humanitarian groups have accused the Japanese government at large of drastically underselling the amount of homeless people living in Japan, even today. Despite the 2010s being a period where homelessness is on the decline and the country's people are supposed to be more sensitive to their plight, the NHK in 2014 reported that of 300 homeless people interviewed for a study in Tokyo, approximately 40% of them had been attacked by groups of young, middle, and upper class men, just like Gin. And it's not a surprise that Japan's homeless became so plentiful and simultaneously vilified when you consider not only the far-reaching cultural weights of maintaining honor, but of how perfect a storm capitalism created for the country's poor. Japan's official interest rate is close to 0%, but borrowing from the bank is ordinarily seen to be shameful and usually requires a guarantor, so many poor people are forced to resort to saraken, short for sararimen kinyu, for loans. They're basically publicly traded loan shark companies, now largely operated through kiosks, that charged interest rates over 30% until they were capped at 20% in 2010, like a decade and a half after the regulation was needed, whose debt collectors harass and assault those who owe them, sometimes until they lose their marriages, their jobs, or both. Something like 10% of the country's population have had to take out loans from one of the over 100,000 that exist. But the total value of these outstanding loans have been estimated to be close to 100 billion, and that's USD. Harder drugs are largely inaccessible unless you're affiliated with the Yakuza, which, by the way, are usually the ones running the larger sarakens, which, by the way, are partnered with the banks that aren't allowed to directly charge those high interest rates. But the addictions which are available and marketed to the Japanese working class, alcohol and gambling, plague the demographic that makes up 98% of Japanese homeless. Men, mostly over 40. In fact, due to Japan never undergoing the process of mainstreaming and still maintaining a population of indefinitely imprisoned mentally ill patients 5 times larger than its prison population, a great deal of Japan's homeless are not in the conventional sense incapable of caring for themselves in the way that a large number of the West's homeless are. They are often people who have families and homes they could try to go back to, but are simply too ashamed to return as a poor man. Weighed down by delinquent bills, gambling debts, alcoholism, or a combination of the three. Of the interviews with Japanese homeless that I read in preparation for the script, the most common sentiment between them, aside from fear of youth assault squads, was that their way of living is a preferable alternative to facing the denunciation of their family if they tried to go home and show their face. Sounds pretty familiar, right? Rather than representing different geographical and cultural origins, Kon's three magi represent the three most overtly oppressed and abused groups of Japanese society. Our Melchior is a poor addict, our Kaspar is a teenage girl, and our Balthazar is a trans woman. A lot of people not from Japan might be surprised to know that only 2% of their homeless are women, but we should disabuse ourselves from the illusion that this means life is in any measurable way better for them because of this. In 2018, Tokyo Medical University, one of the country's foremost schools, was exposed for deducting points from the entrance exams of all female applicants to keep the ratio of women allowed to study there under 30%, because it is commonly believed that women are more likely to resign from a job. In 2007, Hakuo Yanagisawa, the Minister of Health, Labor, and Welfare, said women are childbearing machines in a public speech. In 2016, a report was released that over 60% of assembly women in Japan's diet had been sexually harassed by their male colleagues or even by random male voters. This is 2 years after Ayaka Shiomura, a diet member, had threats and insults yelled at her during her speech advocating for better childcare support. Assemblymen, her co-workers, loudly and angrily interrupted her with comments demanding that she get married, some even questioning if she was fertile enough to give birth. In 2015, the governor of Kagoshima, Yuichiro Ito, questioned the use of even teaching girls trigonometry during a debate on education policy. If you do decide to marry as a woman, your husband is likely barely home due to the labor practices developed in the country's era of rapid industrial growth, demanding that he works insane hours, commonly without overtime pay. So while he inches towards addiction, you raise the children and maintain the house alone. Hiring a babysitter or even a maid is seen as dishonorable, as a failure to perform your duties to your family. Your husband commonly won't come home until after your children are asleep. Because of the prevalence of alcoholism and wide adoption of public transport, there's also an overwhelmingly greater likelihood that he's coming home drunk. Japan didn't have any official anti-domestic violence laws until late 2001, and since then, the number of reported domestic violence cases, statistically still just a sliver of the amount of women who are actually abused, amounted to over 18 times what it was the year the law was put in place. Less than 10% of reported abuses actually result in arrests, but the deaths of women resulting from domestic violence continue to rise. So if you're a woman in Japan who does become homeless, you're usually taken off the street by shelters or social workers, not simply out of empathy from an equal, but much more commonly due to the regressive societal assumption that you simply can't survive on your own. Women are only provided more social programs through which they can attempt to rebuild because it is assumed that the men who command their household or their family have failed them. Progress is certainly being made, but it takes more than a handful of laws and public apologies to escape the reach of their feudal and their imperial past. Japan is one of the most overtly misogynistic societies in the First World, and Miyuki's character is an incredibly bold and loud, but nonetheless lonesome, echo of the internalized anger and resentment that the culture's systemic mistreatment of women has instilled. Gin stumbles out of frame, leaving what he could have become behind, and we cut to Hana and the cab driver from earlier rushing to the rescue of Miyuki. However, rather than expressing concern for her, he instead expresses envy for her armed captor, who he presumes to be her husband, because he wishes his wife could be afraid and quiet like Miyuki. Cut again, and we're back in the apartment, where Miyuki's about to spill the beans on what she's been alluding to since her introduction. the reason she exists as a statistical anomaly. The best summation of Miyuki's dynamic within our trio and of what she represents in the greater social discussion of sexism is this shot from her dream of the stabbing. Stood in between her father as he's doubled over in shock, but with a facial expression and posture more indicative of rage than sadness, and her mother desperately hid behind cover and hopelessly praying because that's how she was raised to respond to the displeasure of men, with fear. But Miyuki isn't just stood between them, she stood above them. She doesn't quickly apologize. She doesn't bend to the mountain of societal expectations that her mother suffers under, nor does she relent in the face of a man's anger, because her anger, the impatience of Japan's women after countless centuries of continuous neglect and abuse, is far greater than the entitled, petty frustration of a patriarch realizing he's been robbed of a subject, or a father's shock when it dawns on him for the first time that his daughter actually minds a lot when her thoughts and feelings are ignored. And this translates directly into Miyuki's demeanor towards the other Magi. Quick to fight Gin and quick to sympathize with Hana. She mocks her mother, but only for her complacency in the face of their neglect and oppression. The multiple references of her Christianity, a not so subtle juxtaposition against their historical fortitude in the face of bondage in their country. Her deeply imbued resentment of the expectation Japan's power structure projects as to what an ideal family should look like is also expressed in the many smiling young girls and nuclear families on billboards, signs, and printed in books that Miyuki is either visually contrasted against or made to directly ridicule. This disconnect with her culturally imposed identity is further explored through Hana's constant correction of her posture, body language, and use of informal language to refer to her parents and her gentle, anxiety-laden interactions with Chiyoko. As the film progresses, these high-angle shots of Miyuki become more prominent, peeling back the imperishable anger she carries to reveal a sensitive and immature and scared young girl. Whether she's crying in a phone booth because she misses her father, but apologizing for the way you conveyed a point to someone you love without retreating on the point you had originally made is painfully difficult adult shit that she shouldn't have to deal with. Or quietly savoring a candy in a waiting room, standing by for her family. And with the mention of family, we're finally brought to Hana, in my opinion, the greatest character that Satoshi Kon ever touched. Japan is often regarded as a progressive country in terms of its treatment of LGBT citizens, at least relatively speaking. The JSDF maintained since the Clinton debates that there were no laws or rules explicitly barring gay and lesbian people from enlisting, and there are currently a number of sitting government officials belonging to the LGBT, beginning with Aya Kamikawa, a trans woman, being elected as a ward councilor of Tokyo in 2003. But things are never really quite as good as they sound. Remember earlier when we talked about Christianity in Japan? Right. Well, it turns out that the mass persecution of Western missionaries and their followers based on mounting xenophobic paranoia didn't sit particularly well with the West, and trade relations became even shakier than they already were. So when bad boy Tokugawa Ieyasu rose to power just a few years after the 26 martyrs, he decided to pump it up and block the entire country from any form of foreign influence, period. Enter the Sakoku Edict of 1635, or as it's sometimes referred to in English, the Closed Country Edict. Anyways, no influence from the Big C for the past 1,000+ years, followed by the shogunate spiking it off stage in the 1600s, meant that Japan existed in a virtually homophobia and transphobia free society all the way up until the Meiji period of the late 19th century, when the new empire took extensive efforts to incorporate more Western beliefs and laws. In fact, same-sex relationships were only ever made illegal in 1872, and it was repealed like 7 years later. In the Edo period, period, women actors were banned from kabuki theater, and in their place rose effeminate male performers because it was believed that only men could really know what the beauty of a woman is. Many of the actors maintained their presentation as women outside of the stage, and thus, without much question, people socialized with and treated them as women. This is actually what Hana's melodramatic demeanor and wildly overblown expressions and body language are based off of. Before the West's influence, Japan conceptualized gender and sexuality nearly entirely within the context of adopted social roles. During and after the 16th century, when wives gained more security and influence, Japanese women commonly pursued same-sex relationships as well. The only importance placed on the air quotes sanctity of marriage was to extend a family's lineage and preserve its honor. And it's because of this that even Japan's most widely exported symbol of masculinity, the samurai, were also one of the most well-documented practitioners of gay relationships in the Eastern world. The term wakashudo, meaning the way of the young men, literally originated with the often exclusive and romantic homosexual relationships practiced between samurai and their pupils, complete with vows. What I'm getting at here is Japan was super gender fluid and super gay for a super long time before the empire copped its Western bigotry expansion pack. And unfortunately, with the US overseeing basically the complete reconstruction of Japanese society, complete with monitoring what media could and could not be produced, the societal aggression and subjugation never completely relented, and instead continued to grow rapidly. Even though now close to 70% of Japan's population supports same-sex marriage, the culturally and historically out-of-left-field hatred for LGBT people still smolders. A not-so-distant past which the older generations, many of whom hold seats in its government, cling to. So same-sex marriage still hasn't been made legal. LGBT people don't receive protection under national anti-discrimination laws. They receive no official recognition as couples from the government or law enforcement, which not only makes it extremely difficult to take out loans, to rent or own homes together, or to visit one another in the hospital, but also means that LGBT victims of domestic abuse are unable to pursue proper recourse in an already broken system which overwhelmingly favors its abuse. Users. Adoption, as well as stepchild and joint adoption, are off the table completely. Lesbian women can't access IVF. Conversion therapy on minors as well as adults still hasn't been made illegal. And the Japanese government only allows trans people to have the gender they identify as recognized on official documents after undergoing an excessive and dehumanizing process that culminates in mandatory sterilization and sexual reassignment surgery. And this law was held up this year by Japan's Supreme Court to reduce confusion in families and society. And it sucks, because since this discrimination is less overt, less common, and less historically ingrained in the collective conscious as either the country's vilification of its poor or its tyranny over its women, it falls somewhere between the cracks. So while Hana is never beaten in the film, although it is implied that she was before due to her lost tooth not being present in flashbacks or pictures, and while she is never overpowered or neglected by a man, she nonetheless suffers the most consistent torrent of aggression out of any character in the entire film. And the discrimination comes from Gin and Miyuki as well. Kon understands how the Western concept of rigid gender norms are often weaponized against trans people. So beginning with this moment when Hana snaps at Gin for misgendering Chiyoko, and continuing until the very last scene of the film when she irritably underlines the fact that they were both admitted to the men's ward, we're never allowed to forget that for Hana, life is a painful and inexhaustible treadmill of microaggressions. But her absolutely dominating rebuke to every single instance of bigotry she's faced with throughout the film is as intoxicating and jubilant as it is empowering. And her devotion, her unending ardor to do good, is reflected in the frequency with which the light is cast against her and the wind elevates her. Fittingly, it is in the scenes and shots which center Hana that these two motifs conspire most remarkably. Following her confrontation with Gin in front of his daughter, Hana explains to Miyuki that her selflessness will ultimately leave her alone. That by the end of their journey, the others will return to families who love them. And that's all that matters. But with Miyuki's barely held together response that she isn't being fair to herself, the wind enters stage left and joins her chorus. The closest this universe has to the hand of God, reminding Hana that despite her loss, there's still so much left to pursue and so much that she already possesses. Family is simply where our love dwells. Whereas in the film's second act, where Gin was led down a dim path of lights without him realizing it, in the film's third act, our trio reaches an impasse in the pursuit of Sachiko, and the light's intervention is so much more resolute and visible with Hana present that the three actually acknowledge it for what it is: guidance. And this pattern of both light and wind becoming progressively more direct in their influence reaches its peak in perfect harmony with Tokyo Godfathers' hair-raising crescendo. Hana, thinking nothing of the risk to her own life, throws herself from the roof to save Chiyoko, and after momentum carries her off a second ledge and gravity rips her from the safety of her subsequent foothold, an unheralded explosion of wind hurtles forward and soars to her rescue. Kamikaze. As her and Chiyoko are gently suspended in air, light envelops them more brilliantly and more precisely than it appears in any other shots in the film. And it is with this cosmic gesture, this final divine intervention, that love finally eclipses strife. In Kon's cycle, this is the passing of the pursuit and the beginning of the possession. Every character, each with their own loss and their own absence of love, warmed, comforted, rejuvenated, and made equal in its radiance. When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." John 8:12. This is, to me, what makes Tokyo Godfathers so special. I said in the first episode of this series that Mima in Perfect Blue is the only character of Kon's to have completely circumnavigated his cycle of love. And I do still believe that a year later. But Tokyo Godfathers manages to surpass Perfect Blue as well as every other piece of Kon's work in the sheer volume of characters given the opportunity to possess love, to mend what they may have broken or rediscover what they may have lost. The wind gives Sachiko a moment of hesitation before her leap and carries her husband's desperate plea to her ears. The light pulls not only our protagonists, but the man harassing them on account of their homelessness and the cashier dragging his feet to defend them out of a store just moments before it is impaled by a speeding ambulance. More than just empathy, Tokyo Godfathers exemplifies mercy. It is the only film of Kon's to feature no death at the hands of another, and his only film where the preeminent antagonist is an amalgam of political missteps and broken social mechanisms, rather than a person or group whose purpose is to echo them. Even those who have explicitly done wrong, like the Yakuza boss, or his lieutenant, or the assassin, or Miyuki's father, or Sachiko, or Yasuo, or the taxi driver, or the drunk guy, or the teens, or Gin, are given clemency, a chance for them to grow, even if some of them maybe aren't deserving of it. It is maybe the best cinematic support I've yet seen for the argument that constraint is conducive to creativity. Its magnificent and at times erratic animation, alongside its brilliant slapstick and sense of comedic timing, combined with its energetic and idiosyncratic score to transform an otherwise bleak glimpse of humanity into something transcendent and hilarious and ecstatic and absurd, but somehow even closer to life than it would have come if it hadn't featured them. With the pervasiveness of its coincidences, Godfathers gleefully leans through the barrier of plausibility at every possible turn and manages to elevate itself to a point where it becomes the most believable story I've ever seen. It is Kon's admittance, halfway through an immaculate body of work, that he never actually needed to evoke the imagery of dreams or delusions or false realities to achieve what he did. Because real life this life is more confusing and absurd and unfair and euphoric than anything any of us could ever make up. If a storm didn't come to Japan's aid in 1281, it would have fallen to a Mongol host. If Giuseppe Zangara wasn't stood on a wobbly chair in 1933, he would have killed FDR instead of the mayor of Chicago, and the US wouldn't have survived the Great Depression. If Carl Jung hadn't been in a session with a patient in the midst of her describing a dream she had of a golden scarab when an insect crashed against his cabinet window until he let it inside, only to discover that he was holding a gold-tinted scarab, he wouldn't have written about the psychological concept which serves as the vertebrae of Tokyo Godfathers' structure: synchronicity. Events with no causal relationship, yet meaningfully related in spite of that. A falling together in time. And there's no better illustration of that, I think, than the closing shot of the film. A dolly backwards out of the room which our trio shares to reveal a perfectly balanced collection of lights. Every room of every floor containing its own weird little world. None more significant or more pronounced than the other, even if one of them contains God, because in their own way, they all do. Maybe we are here on purpose, or maybe we aren't. I don't know. But I do know that love, any kind of it, can make us feel like we are. Maybe that's why we've kept finding different ways to name it or give it form. There's this line from the final movement of Beethoven's Ninth, the one that plays during the old man's death and the reuniting of Gin and his daughter, and it goes, "Brothers, above the canopy of stars must dwell a loving father." I like to think it means for all of us. Have a good night.
And let me play among the stars. Let me see what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars. In other words...
Hey, thanks for watching. Big, big, big thank you to my patrons for making this video possible, especially these guys, and a very special thank you to Ericusant, Aaron Reyes, Altheux, Avid, Bew Jackson, Blake Demby, Brady Kramer, Bran Muffin, Brian Phillips, Charles J. Boyle, Chase Epsi, Denny Ain, Dr. Chike, Elena Lagerman, Eli Z, Gavin Miller, Govols Jack, my boy Ho Shin, Irv Buchbinder, Jacob New, Jacob Helgren, Jan Seiberg, Joe Betts, Joshua Fogelson, Joshua Kodamal, Killer Space, Lana Simmons, The Home Lloyd, Logan Morgangrad, Long Hyun, Luigi Murray, Marwan Mohammed, Michelle Wen, Mohammed El Zofri, Nick Bell, Nick Trupiano, Robert Whaley, Rory Stickler, Shane Vino, Straffin Nathan, Travis Osborne, Tristan Marino, William Cole, and Zion George. Let me know what you thought about what I thought down below or on Twitter if you feel like, and make sure to subscribe. Anyways, love you, love you, love you, and I'll see you next time.